pray with me today. I'm Pastor David Graham of Grace Community Church in Boulder City, Nevada. I'd like you to join me in prayer as we begin this edition of our Grace Community Church online. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. We love you and praise you. Speak to our hearts now and bless us as we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Not too many announcements. By the time you get this, we'll be getting ready to have our annual meeting, and that'll be on January 22nd. And so if you are watching this and can't get to the annual meeting, it'll be at 1 o'clock in the dining room. That's the only announcement I have.
Please sing with me. We are marching in the light of God. We are marching in the light of God.
prayer request we're still holding up in prayer. Heather Wong, she had a perforation in her intestines and got very sick. And it's a long, slow recovery, but she is improving immensely. Would you pray for Condi Wong, the whole family? We ask that you would hold them up in prayer, and as they deal with the challenges that have been presented to them. We also want to thank you for praying for Jan Liebhauser. She's much better. Also, Fran Haraway is much better. There is a lady that comes around here that's homeless and has no place to sleep. I'll just tell you her first name, Monica. And she needs prayer. She's tormented by the enemy. She believes that people are out to get her. She's not well. Her name is Monica. And would you remember her in prayer with me? And then we'll pray the Lord's Prayer. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness. We ask your blessing upon our time, Lord. Now hear our prayer for Heather and Monica. We ask that you would intervene in the name of Jesus, Lord. We're in agreement. You said if any two of us agree asking anything in your name, you would do it. So thank you, Father. We ask your blessing upon everyone who is listening to this, for everyone in our church, Lord. We pray that the annual meeting would go smoothly. We pray that we would all be in agreement and consensus as to the way forward in the coming year of 2023. Thank you, Father, for Grace Community Church in Boulder City, Nevada. We ask for your continued blessing and help us to be a light in the darkness. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, would you join me and let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. We call it the Our Father, but let's pray it together. Shall we begin? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Now, our Old Testament reading is going to be Psalm 63, 1 through 8. O God, you are my God. I earnestly search for you. My soul thirsts for you. My whole body longs for you. In this parched and weary land where there is no water, I have seen you in your sanctuary and gazed upon your power and glory. Your unfailing love is better than life itself. How I praise you. I will praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer. You satisfy me more than the richest feast. I will praise you with songs of joy. I lie awake thinking of you, meditating on you through the night. Because you are my helper, I sing for joy in the shadow of your wings. I cling to you. Your strong right hand holds me securely. Isn't that wonderful words? Psalm 63. You read it on your own and let the Lord minister to your spirit. The Lord is wonderful and good. Now let's look at the New Testament reading. It's found as part of the Sermon on the Mountain. And it's just a few verses, but hear what Jesus said. You have heard the law that says the punishment must match the injury. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I say, do not resist an evil person. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, offer the other cheek also. If you are sued in court and your shirt is taken from you, give your coat too. If a soldier demands that you carry his gear for a mile, carry it 2 miles. Give to those who ask, and don't turn away from those who want to borrow.
Swarms around me, there is peace amid the strife, and your presence surrounds me like a gentle rain, bringing me home again in the stillness. In the stillness there is peace, though the mind runs in confusion and I only see the winning and the losing. There you comfort me with your tranquility in the stillness. In the stillness you are here, blessing every single moment, whispering so very near, though I didn't even know. Smiling through, though I wander and I lose my way, I'm never alone nor far from home in the stillness. In the stillness you are here, blessing every single moment, whispering so very near, though I didn't even know it, how you're there for me, calling quietly, waiting patiently for me to be. In the stillness there with you, any time of night or day, your love comes smiling through, though I wander and I lose my way, I'm never alone nor far from home in the stillness.
And And so the title of the sermon today is The Second Mile Principle. And I borrow it from the phrase in Matthew 5:41, and if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him too. So to go the second mile means that you do more than is expected of you. Second mile living should be a character trait of all believers, of all Christians, all those who say we are disciples of Jesus Christ. And we can begin to live like this any moment, any day, right now. Second mile living will increase your net worth to the world. Yeah. It will bring you favor, honor, and blessings. Second mile living is just one of the many ways we can fulfill God's command to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. So let's look at the text within the context. This second mile living that he preaches about is the new ethic of living in the coming kingdom of God. And he begins this by saying, don't resist evil. He begins by stating the old way, the way life was lived for centuries. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. You see, most cultures in the world believe that that's justice. If someone poked your eye out, you had a right to poke one of theirs out. If someone knocked one of your teeth out, it's perfectly okay to knock one of their teeth out. Can you see what kind of chaos this would cause in the world? The world was full of angry people, all trying to get even with each other. Revenge was how wrongs were supposed to be righted. And it sort of makes logical sense, right? But it never worked. Didn't work then, doesn't work now. When Jesus said, don't resist evil, he intended to blunt the force of revenge and turn evil inside out. If anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. If anyone would sue you and take your coat, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to him who begs from you, and do not refuse him who would borrow from you. In each of these examples, the wronged individual is asked to respond in an unexpected way, a higher way, a better way. So, I don't want to belabor that, but it felt good to exact revenge. If someone steals your rake, you go get his rake. But Jesus said differently. He said, if anyone hits you on the right cheek, calmly offer him the other to hit also. No one had ever said things like that before. It didn't make any sense. It wasn't logical. It was a new ethic he was trying to share. It was the way things are going to be done in the coming kingdom of God on earth. This one teaching on non-resistance to evil helped Gandhi yank India out from under the rule of its colonial masters in the early 20th century. His non-violent protest movement was founded upon this teaching of Jesus and not fighting back. When the authorities would beat and hit the marchers, they simply took it without fighting back. And by doing so, listen carefully, they broke the power of force to control. It must have been very hard. But in the end, nonviolent resistance to evil blunted its power, turned it inside out, and won India her freedom and independence. Martin Luther King Jr. studied Gandhi when he was getting his doctorate at Boston College. And he decided to use the same tactic in the civil rights movement. He taught all those who sat at lunch counters that when they were punched or dragged out, they were not to fight back. They were not to resist. And frankly, it was a very hard thing to do, but it also worked very well. because in so doing, they literally broke the power of force to control by actually submitting to it. It's the secret of Christ non-resistance to the evil and injustice that was meted about on him. When they put him on trial, the Bible says he opened not his mouth. He didn't try to defend himself. And he didn't call for his followers to take up arms to fight back. And when Peter pulled out the sword in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said, "Peter, put your sword back." And the ear that was cut off, Jesus picked up and placed it back on there and healed him. Counterintuitive. It's not easy to do. In fact, in this entire section in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is talking about loving one's enemies. This explains that this is done by doing the exact opposite of what would normally be expected. It would require self-control. And in all cases, it would require the help of the Holy Spirit. Somebody hits you, let them hit you again. Someone wants your coat, give him your shirt also. Now, this story about if anyone makes you walk with them for 1 mile, go ahead and walk with them 2 miles, really is about the Roman occupation of Palestine. In those times, a soldier would require any of the conquered peoples to help them. And soldiers had to carry a lot of baggage, a lot of armor, a lot of gear and things like that. It was heavy to carry. So they would compel one of the conquered peoples, in this case, the Jews in Palestine, to carry their gear for them for a long time. And it began to be a very onerous burden. So the Jewish leaders got together with the Roman authorities in Palestine, and they worked it out that if a soldier wanted a Jewish person to carry their gear, they would only have to carry it 1 mile. And after a mile, they could say, "We have an agreement. You can't make us carry it any farther." And here Jesus then says, look, if a soldier asks you to pick up his gear and carry it 1 mile, go ahead and carry it a second mile. Do more than what was required, more than what was expected. Can you see how that would, in essence, heap coals of fire on that person's head? In essence, actually make them wonder why you are doing it? And that would help them realize that you were a different thinking kind of person, that you would be willing to go with them 2 miles voluntarily. And then he says, give money to people who are begging, and don't refuse those who want to borrow something from you. And all of these new behaviors, sort of like upside down from the world's norms, the idea is to be willing to do more than is expected. In writing to the church at Rome, Paul explained the second mile principle this way: do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. That's Romans 12, 21. So second mile living ought to be our lifestyle as believers, as Christians, as followers of Jesus Christ. Not only will we overcome evil by going the second mile, but if we make second mile living a way of life, we will bless others in such a way that they will see Jesus in us, in our lives, and maybe want to have a relationship with God themselves. Let me look at a couple of biblical examples. This second mile principle was operating in the life of Rebekah. Remember, Abraham sent his servant to find a bride for his son Isaac. And he went a long ways to where their relatives were, their family were. And so when he got to this particular location, he asked for a drink. And a young lady came up and gave him the drink, and then blessed him by watering his camels. That was an example of second mile living. And because of that, Abraham's servant knew that that was the person picked out to be Isaac's bride, his wife. She had a heart of service. Not only was she willing to comply with the request to give him a drink, which required great effort to lower something down into the well to get the water and then bring it back up and then pour it into a vessel for him to drink. She noticed her camel, his camel, he had 10 camels. They were dry and hot and thirsty. She went back to the well over and over and over again to provide water for all of the camels. And because that principle was operating in her life, she received far more than she could ever hope to dream of expecting. She was going to be wed to a very wealthy man, one of the wealthiest in that part of the world, just because she was a second mile girl. Jesus taught this principle of second mile living in a number of his illustrations. And answering the question that the Pharisees had asked him about, who is your neighbor, when he quoted, you must love God with all your heart, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself, the man said, well, who's my neighbor? And Jesus told the story of the Good Samaritan. This fellow found a wounded man lying in a ditch. First, he bandaged him up, and then he did more. He went the second mile. He put him on his donkey, took him to a motel, and paid the room rent until the man would be better. Now, most of us would have thought that we had done a wonderful good deed by taking the time out of our busy day to bandage the man. Oh, didn't we do something good? But this Samaritan had biblical character. He was a second mile man. Because of his faithfulness, he has been immortalized. We're talking about him thousands of years later. That's the power of second mile living. In Luke's gospel, he teaches this principle a little bit differently. Hear the words of the Lord Jesus, but love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great, and you will be sons and daughters of the Most High. For he is kind to the ungrateful and the selfish. He is merciful, even as your Father is merciful. Be merciful, even as your Father is merciful. So he concluded this teaching of second mile living by saying, give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, will be poured into your lap. For the measure you give will be the measure you get back. That's Luke 6:35-38. Now, this language about measures being pressed down, shaken together is a harvest metaphor. In those days, gleaners would follow the harvesters wearing large aprons. There was always extra grain on the ground, and they would pick it up and put it in their aprons, and they would fill it up, and then they would shake the apron so the grain would settle even more, so more could be put in until it was literally running over their apron. They could no longer carry it. Well, Jesus is sharing here one of the most profound aspects of second mile living. When we go the extra mile, when we give beyond expectation, when we bless others this way, others eventually will notice and bless us in return. If we give a little, we will only receive a little. But if we give a lot, we will be given a lot in abundance. So do what's expected of you and then some. That's what Jesus was trying to help us understand. This, by the way, principle is really a wise principle for all kinds of upward mobility in business, sports, and life, just about anything. When anyone goes and does more than what is generally expected, they will receive back in return the rewards for that effort. So we can make this message practical today in our minds and hearts by beginning to think how we can manifest second mile living in our daily lives. How do we do that? By simply doing more than it's expected. Assignments, if you're in school, your homework assignments, your job duties, even in your relationship with your neighbors and your relatives. Second mile people will always be blessed with friends. People will notice that you are different. It may sometimes be costly in terms of time or money or even effort, but second mile living will help others see Jesus in us. They will see Jesus in your life. Perhaps they will be touched by your kindness or your efforts and be drawn to the Lord. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I surrender my will to you. Make me a second mile Christian, Lord. Help me to always realize that I can do what's expected and then just a little bit more, or maybe even a lot more. But Father, thank you for your teaching to help us understand how to live our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please join me in singing, Make Me a Servant. Make me a servant, humble and meek. Lord, let me lift up those who are weak, and may the prayer of my heart always be. Make me a servant, make me a servant, make me a servant today.
Thank you.